Hello, aspirants. Looking at current affairs for 27th Feb, the news items picked up from the Hindu newspaper are these eight. We'll look at them in detail. The first one, Bank of Baroda's role in South Africa's Gupta scandal. So this is regarding the Gupta scandal in South Africa. So here the Guptas who are of Indian origin, they have settled, the Gupta brothers, they have settled in South Africa and they have very good relations with South African president who has stepped down now. Mr. Jacob Zuma. So he had to resign because of his financial dealings with the Gupta brothers. So it seems the Gupta brothers had full control over the government and all the deals and policies which were being framed. So in this case, even Bank of Baroda is involved. Bank of Baroda officials actually suppressed alerts which were filed by junior officials at its Johannesburg branch in South Africa. So these transactions which were taking place in the accounts belonging to the Gupta brothers, there were discrepancies, but they were never brought out in the open because of senior bank officials of Bank of Baroda in Johannesburg suppressing these alerts. And that is why they never reached South African Financial Intelligence Center. So these are now, the details are coming out. So the bank continued to allow the Gupta brothers to operate a web of accounts to create a complex corporate maze. So the other banks actually terminated their dealings with the Gupta brothers in 2016, but here the accounts in Bank of Baroda, they received payments from state-run enterprises against bills that are under scrutiny now. So the large sums of money was sent abroad to shifted, large sums of money was shifted to even shell companies. So all these dealings are now coming out in the open. Former President Jacob Zuma's fourth wife was also an employee as such of the Gupta firm. She was paid $12,300 per month salary, which is one of the highest paid private sector executive salary in South Africa. So these close links between Gupta brothers and the government under former President Jacob Zuma is being investigated into now. So a huge amount of money in the Bank of Baroda accounts of the Gupta brothers is illegal. And even the Bank of Baroda has sought the nod of the Central Vigilance Commission as such in India to initiate major penalty proceedings against two of its officials, including the former CEO of its South Africa operations. So even Bank of Baroda has decided to shut down its South Africa operations in wake of the scandal. So here we had discussed this earlier too, the Guptas of South Africa. So here the details are provided how they had close relations with Jacob Zuma family and how they had links with, because of which even military officials, you can see, senior military officials of South Africa were ordered to act as welcoming party and custom rules were not followed. As such, when there was this wedding guests were brought into South Africa at the military base. So how they were exploiting the resources of the government, the military, and they had a huge stake in the power sector here too, you can see. Then even in governance, they had mining, sports, aviation. So all these links with the Gupta brothers had in the South African government are being, the circle of influence is being mentioned here. Then next is social media executives to monitor local news. So Information and Broadcasting Ministry has now decided that they'll hire 716 social media executives. That means one social media executive for each district of the country. And these, as such, what their main purpose is for is sharper delivery of the government's message to the voters. So means the main responsibility would be to analyze local news media and help the government adapt the messages according to the responses to it. So what response the local media is providing. So even they'll monitor local editions of newspapers, local cable channels, audio channels, local social media handles as such. So all important local developments would be brought to their notice, and then they would analyze this and find out whether the government's message is received positively or negatively by the people. So these social media executives would be appointed. So even there's a new media wing which has been set up, Broadcast Engineering Consultant India Limited. So the Ministry of Information and Broadcasting also recently, we saw with respect to budget too, there was real-time monitoring of public online conversations around the word budget. So how the people are receiving the budget, the government's messages, that is being looked into. Open forums like Twitter, Facebook as such, blogs, they were read closely by this unit of Information Broadcasting Ministry under Smriti Irani, and based on that, government's message was modified and brought forth. So they were learning from the social media channels. So this is now being formalized. Social media executives will be hired. Then next is Assam Arunachal can resolve border dispute. So this is regarding Assam and Arunachal Pradesh, the two northeastern states. They have this border dispute. Actually, it was out of Assam, Greater Assam, that Arunachal Pradesh was formed as a separate state, first a union territory, and then it became a state. So till 1978, they were together. Arunachal became Pradesh was separated later, and it also got the status of a state after that. So here, basically, the border dispute, which is there, decades old border dispute now. So there are proposals to resolve this through dialogues, meaningful dialogue. Means the Assam and Arunachal government, both are now BJP ruled states. So they would come together for meaningful dialogue and resolve this dispute. The Assam irrigation minister was in Arunachal Pradesh for this tribal festival called Nyokum Yulu. So this is a festival celebrated by Nishi community of Arunachal Pradesh to invoke God's blessing for good harvest and communal harmony. So we are seeing that Assam is also having a similar dialogue with Nagaland too. So Assam, Nagaland also have border dispute. So these are being proposed to be resolved now through talks. So here the details are provided of these northeastern states. So claims by Arunachal Pradesh. Some regions are being claimed by Arunachal Pradesh. Some regions claimed by Nagaland from Assam. So you can see here. Even there is Manipur-Nagaland conflict in this region. Mizoram, claims of Mizoram here shown. Right? Then Meghalaya claim from Assam. In these two regions. So these border disputes are there which need to be resolved. Then next is Kaveri board not likely soon. So this is water resources minister, the central water resources minister Nitin Gadkari, who has said that the Kaveri management board, which has to be established after the Supreme Court gave its recent ruling on Kaveri water dispute. So we saw the dispute, the tribunal award in this case has been modified by the Supreme Court order. So the total available water sought 740 TMC feet, which we had discussed recently. So allocation for the four riparian states was so. But then in a normal year, it is said Karnataka releases some amount of water, monthly deliveries. And in distress years, the proportionate share of water for all four states reduces. So actually, there's a need for Kaveri management board, which ensures that this monthly release of water and this order is being as such followed. So this Kaveri management board, which the tribunal called for, was never set up by the government. The dispute went to the Supreme Court too. Supreme Court has modified this tribunal award as follows, you can see. So it has asked for more allocation for Bengaluru, Kerala, Puducherry. Has not changed, the allocation remains the same, but from Karnataka to Tamil Nadu, the water which has to be released has reduced. So this change which has been brought in by the Supreme Court verdict recently has to be implemented, and for that it is necessary that Kaveri Management Board be established. But then this Kaveri Management Board, when would it be established by the central government? There is no clear timeline, and the Union Water Resources Minister was also non-committal on this. That when would it be done? It is in the process is what is being stated. Also on water, another two projects have been highlighted by the minister. These are, one is diverting water from Godavari to Kaveri. So this is a project which is being highlighted, and the Polavaram project. So these will cater to the needs of the southern states here. So around, the minister says that around 3000 TMC feet of water in Godavari goes to the sea and is unused. So that is why this linking Godavari and Kaveri is being taken up as a project which will cost about 1 lakh crore. And the Polavaram project, which we have discussed quite often, this is a 60,000 crore project which the government plans to complete before March 2019. So we'll see these two also. Here, this is regarding Godavari-Kaveri river link project. So surplus water from Godavari will be transferred to Nagarjuna Sagar project, and then in the Krishna basin, from where it will further go to the Kaveri basin. So this will also result in displacement of villages, loss of forest land, also submergence of villages would take place. So of course there are concerns, but this is a project in a very initial phase, Kaveri Godavari leveling project, and the Polavaram project, which we have discussed quite often. So this is linking Godavari and Krishna river through this Polavaram canal. So water from Godavari would be diverted to Krishna here. So this is majorly going to benefit the region here in Andhra Pradesh. Of course, here also there are concerns that it would affect the environment. It would result in less water available in Godavari basin. So flooding may take place. So concerns are also there. Then this is regarding the entire interbasin water transfer links plans, proposals which are there. So there are two sections of rivers, the Himalayan rivers and the peninsular rivers. So these red lines actually show the canals which are proposed to link rivers. So here you can see how Godavari is being linked to Kaveri to here. Then here Krishna being linked to Pennar, Godavari to Krishna. So all these are proposals as such, plans. Then next is, in a record, over 4 lakh olive ridleys nest at Rushikulya. So this is regarding Rushikulya Rukiri coast in Ganjam district in Odisha. Here 4,28,083 mother olive ridley turtles have nested. So this endangered species, it has created an all-time record of mass nesting at Rushikulya Rukiri. In 2017, there were 3,65,000 nests, and now they have gone to more than 4 lakh. So actually in 2016, for some unexplained reason, there was no mass nesting at Rushikulya coast, but this time it is a record which has been set. Also, the largest mass nesting site for olive ridley turtles along the Indian coastline is Gahirmatha beach. But presently Gahirmatha and the other major mass nesting site, Debi river mouth, this has not seen mass nesting start, has not yet started here. So these are the three regions which you should know about: Rushikulya, Gahirmatha and Debi river. So we'll see in the map too. Here you can see, so these are the three major mass nesting sites. This is Rushikulya river, where we are presently seeing record mass nesting. Then this is the Debi river, or Debi river. So the mouth of Debi river also sees mass nesting, and the largest mass nesting takes place here on Gahirmatha beach coast. So this is there. Also sporadic nesting, a little nesting takes place here in the adjoining entire coastline of Odisha too. So this is regarding olive ridley turtles. It has been in use quite often, so you should know these regions. Then next is, ICAI favors existing audit mechanism. So the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India has said that it supports efforts to strengthen the existing disciplinary and oversight mechanism through amendments to the Chartered Accountants Act. So this has come to the in news because of the recent bank frauds, and also the role of chartered accountants in bank scams has been questioned. Finance Minister also called this as failure of auditors and regulators to detect frauds. So this Institute of Chartered Accountants of India is calling for the strengthening the act as such, and oversight being increased, rather than setting up a super regulator as the government proposes. This is National Financial Reporting Authority, which has been, you know, proposed to be set up to regulate the CA profession. So this is there. The Institute of Chartered Accountants of India, ICAI, argues that such super regulators have been established in US also. So SOX has been set up. SOX is a legislation which has set up such a regulator, but the banking sector mortgage scam, which resulted in the financial crisis in US in 2008-09, took place despite this super regulator being in place. So it's called such actions as failures. That is why it says that ICAI, which is an elected self-regulatory body of a professional audit, so this has to be further strengthened. So this is the argument which they are putting forth. They say that even the amendments to the CA Act have already been put forth to the before the central government, draft amendments. So the high level committee of the central government should take this matter forward and not establish this National Financial Reporting Authority. A provision for this has already been made in the Companies Act. The Companies Act of 2013 has this provision, so it has not been established yet. So this is a body which has been proposed to be established to recommend, monitor and enforce compliance of accounting and auditing standards. It will make recommendations to the central government on auditing and accounting policies and standards that should be adopted by companies. So this is there. It will be a powerful authority. It will enforce compliance. It has special powers vested in it. It has power to investigate persons or body corporate for professional or other misconduct by any member of ICAI, Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. So ICAI actually opposes this super regulator. Then next is KYC compliance needed only for reloading e-wallets. So RBI has said that KYC compliance, which it had sought in October 2017 itself, RBI had directed that all prepaid payment instruments like these e-wallets, so these including the mobile wallets, they have to be fully KYC compliant, means know your customer guidelines have to be followed. So this deadline was provided of December 31, 2017, which has been extended to February 28 now, and now RBI has said that e-wallets which are not compliant with KYC till date 2 after the deadline has been extended to, they will still be allowed to use the money which is there in their wallet, but they will not be allowed to reload the wallet with more funds until their accounts become fully KYC compliant. So this is being stated. So such e-wallets are there, mobile wallets are there. So RBI has issued license to 55 non-bank mobile wallets as such, and also another 50 banks have their own wallets. So such wallets you must have heard of. These are prepaid payment instruments for various apps, etc. too. You have such wallets in which you can store the money and use them accordingly. So they have to be fully KYC compliant. So the RBI argues that this is important so that there is interoperability possible too. So these prepaid payment instruments can be linked to bank accounts and even the cards. So interoperability amongst the wallets also is being sought through the unified payment interface as such within 6 months. So RBI is going to bring out further details on this interoperability too soon. So they want full KYC compliance here. So here the earlier order is being stated that by end of December 2017, complete KYC compliance was sought for these wallets. And even e-wallets were allowed for companies which had a minimum net worth of 5 crore at the time of application and 15 crore within 3 financial years of receiving the note. Also, there is a cost for KYC compliance, know your customer compliance. It is said to be around 150 to 200 per user. So this is a cost which the companies will have to bear. Major companies are also named here. So here concerns had raised because it results in increase in the cost, customer acquisition cost increases for such e-wallets, and full KYC compliance for small ticket transactions. E-wallets are generally used for small amount of money. This is considered as a hindrance as such. So industry members were also asking that the deadline should be extended till such time till Aadhaar is linked to mobile numbers. So then KYC through Aadhaar will be directly possible. But RBI is insisting that this be completed now by the deadline, which is Feb 28. Otherwise, reloading in the e-wallets will not be allowed. Then the last news item is power plants face coal shortage, says report. So the power sector is facing coal shortage again, as 46 coal-fired power plants reported stocks of less than a week. So there are around 113 power plants which are monitored by Central Electricity Authority, and it is seen that out of these 46 have less than a week coal. So they should at least have 15 days of coal available. Some are also at supercritical coal stock situation, means they have coal stocks of less than 4 days. Some even have 0 day stock, 1 day stock as such too. So such details are coming forth. So even earlier during monsoon 2017 too, we saw coal shortage because of flooding in some regions too. At that time too, power, coal and railway ministries had taken series of measures to improve the supplies to power plants. Also, power prices at energy exchanges came very high. It went to rupees 11 per unit. So again, such a situation has arisen, and the government has taken various steps since Jan 2018 to dedicated railway transportation has been proposed, that there should be dedicated railway transportation to transfer coal to these power plants as such. Also, it is proposed that power plants should be set up only within 500 kilometers from the coal mines, so that coal supplies can be boosted to these power plants. So here the details as such are also provided of how coal thermal power plants have supercritical level of coal stock, and there is a need for coal shortage to be taken care of. Even it is said that Coal India is not able to meet the supply obligations, and we have recently also seen how coal mining has been opened up to the private sector, which will also improve the situation. So these are the news items. Thank you.